Passwords are a terrible way of doing security and they're going to get you hacked. You should be using something like this instead. Here's why. Welcome back to the Pro Tech Show. We all use passwords on the internet, but we really shouldn't. Think about it, a password needs to be complicated enough that a computer can't guess it, but simple enough that you can remember it. It's your brain versus a computer. But computers can do billions of calculations per second and get faster every year. Sadly, my brain doesn't. That's not even the worst part. Every time you use a password to sign up for something or to log in, you literally give away your key, making them massively vulnerable to theft. Everyone agrees they're a bad idea. Whilst it's easy to get everyone to agree that something is bad, it's really difficult to get everyone to agree on what to use instead. Hence why passwords are still around. To replace passwords, you need all of the biggest tech companies in the world to agree on what to replace them with, which is exactly what the FIDO Alliance have done. Just about every tech company you've heard of is a member, and they have defined new ways of authenticating online that do not require passwords. The solution exists and you can use it today. We're just waiting for the rest of the internet to catch up so passwords can become a thing of the past. The device I'm using is called a YubiKey. This is not the only way of doing passwordless authentication, but it is a convenient, secure, and well-supported one. As well as supporting FIDO's current standard, it supports older attempts at reducing the risk of passwords through multi-factor and passwordless authentication. Things you're probably familiar with, like smart cards and one-time passcodes. The fact that this works with all of them makes it really useful, because you're not limited to just websites using FIDO2, and because Yubico have been making these things for quite a while, they have a huge list of compatible services. To be clear, this video is not sponsored, and this is not the only device you can use, but that broad support is the reason I recommend it. Because YubiKeys are so popular, if a website supports strong authentication and is going to write a guide on how to use it, they're probably going to write one for one of these. I'll link them in the description, but let me show you how it works first. I've set up KeyCloak as a demo using web authentication. The terminology is a little confusing here, but if you see the words W3C Web Authentication API, WebAuthn or FIDO2, it means the same thing. You might also see UTF or UAF, those were older FIDO standards, FIDO1 essentially. Let's log in. I need to have my YubiKey plugged in, and it asks for a PIN. Then I need to tap the button on the key. That's it, easy peasy and much more secure than a password. But why? One obvious reason is that you need this physical device to log in. That makes it invulnerable to remote attacks over the internet, unlike a password that can be guessed at from anywhere. There's much more to it than that though. Let's look at what actually happened when I pressed that button. We'll start with how passwords work so you can see the difference. When you sign up for an account using a password, you have to send a copy of the password to the website. Every time you ask to log in, the website asks for your password and compares it to the one they recorded when you signed up. The password is your key, but every time you use it, it is exposed on your computer where it could be stolen by malware. Then it is exposed in transit, where it could be stolen by a man-in-the-middle attack or over an insecure connection. It is also permanently exposed on the website itself, where they keep a copy. When that website gets hacked, and it really is a when rather than an if, they've got your key. There are some things that can be done about that last point. Websites shouldn't literally store your password as is. Many do, unfortunately, but there are things they can do to make it more difficult for attackers, like a technique called hashing. Hashing is a mathematical function that takes information and spits out a fixed length value. The principles are that every time you calculate the hash of the same information, the hash will be the same. If the information changes even a tiny bit, the hash will be completely different. The hash is also not reversible. By that I mean you cannot take the hash value and work back from it to find the original information. This is useful for passwords because instead of storing your actual password, the website can instead store the hash of your password. Every time you log in, it hashes the password you supply and compares it to the stored hash. If the hashes match, then it knows you provided the correct password. The advantage of doing it this way is that when the website gets hacked, the bad guys steal the hash of your password and not the password itself. Unfortunately, this is not perfect, and unless you've used a really long password, the hash can be easily cracked using pre-computed lists called rainbow tables. The right thing for a website to do with the password is to salt, hash, and stretch it. But we're not going to go into that now, other than to say that many, if not most of them, don't. And it only addresses one of the places where your password is exposed, because you still have to send your password to the website every single time you log in anyway. Instead, let's show how this process compares to the method our YubiKey uses. This relies on something called public key cryptography that might sound a little intimidating, but the basics are easy to understand. Cryptography means encryption, taking readable data and scrambling it up so nobody can read it without a special key. There's a big difference between TV and reality here. On TV, there's always a computer specialist who has to crack the encryption. You know the scene, right? How long will it take you to crack the encryption? About an hour. You've got 30 minutes. Then, of course, they manage it just in time. In the real world, the correct answer to how long will it take you to crack the encryption is millions of years. It's just not happening unless they messed up and didn't encrypt it properly in the first place. The type of encryption you're probably familiar with from TV is symmetric encryption. You encrypt information using a key, and then it's impossible to read without the same key. This is pretty accurate for a lot of encryption, but public key cryptography works a little differently. It is asymmetric and uses two different keys. The deal is that information encrypted using one key can only be decrypted using the opposite key. That's all you need to know for this. Two keys, and if you encrypt something using one key, then the only way to read it is with the other key. One of these we call the private key, and the other we call the public key. You're now an encryption expert, so let's show how this actually gets used. When you sign up for an account using web authentication, your YubiKey generates a new public and private key pair and sends the public key to the website. The private key stays on the YubiKey. The public key, as the name suggests, is not intended to be a secret. We're sending a copy to the website to make sure they have a copy, not because we need them to keep it safe. If you're watching this video in a web browser and click on the padlock icon at the top, you'll be able to see YouTube's certificate. That certificate contains YouTube's public key. Public keys are meant to be public knowledge, so when the website gets hacked and our public key gets stolen, we don't care. Already better than a password. When you ask to log into the website, instead of asking for your key, the website sends you a bunch of information and asks you to sign it. That information, amongst other things, includes a random challenge and the address of the website. The challenge is just some randomly generated information. It doesn't matter what it is, and it's different every time. Now, you already know how a digital signature works, because they use hashing and public key cryptography. It's important to note that the actual signing gets done by the YubiKey, not your computer. The YubiKey calculates the hash of the data sent by the website. Once it has that hash, it encrypts it using your private key. That encrypted hash is the signature. The YubiKey gives the signature to your computer to send back to the website. To confirm your identity, the website simply needs to decrypt the signature, which it can do using your public key. If that decryption works, if they can decrypt it using the public key they have on file for you, then they know it must have been signed using your private key, proving you're the owner of the correct YubiKey. The website then compares the decrypted hash value from the signature to the correct hash value for the data they sent you. Thanks to the randomly generated challenge, if those hashes match, then they know that not only was this signature generated using your YubiKey, but it was generated in response to this specific login attempt. If someone managed to steal the signature in transit, they won't be able to reuse it, because every login attempt will have a different randomly generated challenge in it, and the hashes of the data wouldn't match. The other information I mentioned that gets sent to be signed is the address of the website. This prevents man-in-the-middle attacks, where you get tricked into accessing a fake website that simply presents a real one through to you and passes on everything you type into it while stealing your information at the same time. How does the YubiKey prevent this? Because when it generates your keys, they are tied to the address of the website. If you connect to a fake website by accident, then one of two things is going to happen. Either it passes through the data to be signed as is, in which case your browser will notice that the website address in the signature request doesn't match the website you're connected to. Or they try to fudge it with their fake scammer website address, in which case it's not going to match the key in the YubiKey and the signatures will be different anyway. In either case, even if you don't notice you've been tricked, either your browser or your YubiKey will. This is so much more secure than a password. In this setup, the private key is the equivalent to the password, but not only is it a much longer and cryptographically secure key, it is never directly exposed anywhere. Throughout all of this, the key never leaves your YubiKey device. It's not even visible to your computer. It can't be attacked over the internet, No one can log on without first plugging our key into their computer. The only thing the website needs to store is a public key, which doesn't matter if it gets stolen. If a login attempt gets cloned, it won't work, and the identity of the website you're connected to is validated automatically to ensure your YubiKey only responds to legitimate login requests that have not been tampered with. This is why these things beat passwords by a wide margin. One thing I didn't quite explain though was that PIN code. Isn't that kind of like a password? No. That's actually optional, but it's a good idea. If you've been on this channel before, you'll probably have heard me bang on about multi-factor authentication. Essentially, you should make sure you need to prove your identity in more than one way. YubiKeys are great, but if all you have to do is plug it in, then if someone else gets hold of it, you're screwed. Like if you get mugged, then the mugger has access to all of your online accounts. The PIN code makes a YubiKey strong authentication, multi-factor authentication. You now need a combination of something you have, the YubiKey, and something you know, the PIN code. If you lose it or someone steals it, they can't use it to log in without also knowing your PIN. The PIN is not as insecure as a password though. You might think it would be vulnerable to brute force guessing attempts, but you'd be wrong. The PIN is handled by your YubiKey, not your computer, and it only lets you have a certain number of attempts. Now this still sounds like a password, but it is different. Passwords will typically lock you out for a short time if you guess wrong too many times in a row within a short space of time. In most cases, that password will unlock after a cooldown period, or at least someone can choose to unlock it, at which point the attack can continue. With a PIN in the YubiKey, you have 8 attempts. It doesn't matter if you use them all up in 10 seconds or 10 years, you've 8 tries. Every time you use one, it's gone, and the only way to reset the counter is to get the PIN right. If it reaches 0, you permanently lose access to all of your FIDO private keys. There is no way to unlock it, they're gone. Brute force attacks don't work when you only get 8 tries. You can't make password lockouts this secure, because if your account self-destructed after 8 password attempts, all an attacker would need to do is spam your website with random password attempts and they could take your entire business down. It works for a YubiKey because you need physical access to even attempt it. Nobody can spam it over the internet. If you don't want to use a PIN but still want to be extra secure, Yubico do sell more advanced versions where the button you press is a fingerprint reader, so you can use biometrics as a second factor instead of a PIN code. There are a few different models of these with different connectors like USB-A, USB-C and Lightning. The one I have supports NFC, so I can tap it against my phone instead of plugging it in. You can find one to suit your devices. I'll try and find a few links and put them below. If you use any of those, it doesn't cost any more, but it does help support the channel. Obviously, I think these are a good option, but before you go clicking on the links and buy one for everyone in your family or your business, are there any downsides? Yeah, there are, so let's talk about those. Firstly, the elephant in the room. Not every site supports these. Many websites are stuck in the past. I don't consider this a reason not to use them, but ultimately there's a bit of chicken and egg going on here, where many websites aren't going to implement it until enough people want it. The only way to progress that is to start using them and give websites a hard time for not supporting it until they bow to the pressure. By them, I don't necessarily mean YubiKeys. I mean FIDO2 or Web Authentication. Like I said at the start, this is not the only device. In fact, in some cases you can use an Android phone as your FIDO2 authenticator. That's not as well supported right now, and it does make me nervous about storing my keys on something that physically fragile, but there are standards for syncing the key between your phone and your online accounts, so you can move it to a new device. Of course, if you can't get into your account to get your key, because you need your key to get into your account, that will be a problem. There will be ways around this, but sometimes, simple is good. It's also good for security. The phone-based method uses Bluetooth to check the device is physically close to the computer you're logging in with. But because smartphones run full operating systems with apps, they can themselves be hacked. I'm not saying it's 100% impossible that someone will eventually find a way to hack a YubiKey, but to my knowledge it hasn't happened yet, and they have a tiny attack surface compared to a phone. Of the websites that do support FIDO2 standards, only some of them have gone full passwordless. Others simply use your YubiKey as a second factor to a password. It's still more secure than a text message or an app prompt, but obviously some people didn't get the memo that these aren't supposed to just supplement a password, they're supposed to replace it. Another thing to think about is what do you do if you lose your YubiKey or it breaks? If this is the only way into your accounts, you'd be in trouble. Yubico's suggestion is to have a backup key. Every time you register a new account, you add both YubiKeys to it. That way, if you lose one, you have a backup. That's a fairly sensible suggestion. The way most accounts work by default is by registering multiple reset methods, like maybe a text message, an email to registered address, or a multi-factor app prompt. The problem with having these enabled is it somewhat undermines the security of your YubiKey, because an attacker could just tell your provider that they've lost the YubiKey and use a reset mechanism to target a weaker authentication type like SMS. I look at this like a journey. On day one, you'll be adding your YubiKey as an additional second factor alongside the ones you already have. That benefits you immediately because there's no way for someone to attack these through multi-factor spamming, and they're resistant to man-in-the-middle attacks. Then over time, as more websites adopt full passwordless, you can start cutting away weak authentication methods until maybe you're left with two YubiKeys or a YubiKey and a phone. Going back to that scenario of how you recover the key on a new phone if you need the key to get to the key, this could be your backup to your phone in case it breaks or runs out of battery. The last challenge you might have using these, and this is more for businesses than home users, is remote or virtual desktops. These are designed to be plugged into the device you're using, or at least tapped against them using NFC. If the device you're sitting at is just acting as a dumb terminal and your real computer is in a data center or the cloud, that poses a problem. That's not to say it won't work, but there are a lot of variables. Whether your YubiKey will pass through to the remote device correctly depends on the remote access technology you're using, the application you're connecting to, and the type of authentication you're using. In some cases, it won't work. With other combinations, it will. If this is something that applies to you, if you use virtual desktop infrastructure or remote desktops, then buy a couple of these and test all of your applications before ordering a few hundred of them for your staff. I mean, you should do that anyway, but especially do it if you're not actually plugging it into the real end user device under some kind of remote redirection in play, because that can cause problems. Those are some of the pros and cons. The more websites adopt full passwordless and the more FIDO2 compliant devices we see in the market, the better, because passwords really aren't good enough anymore. Let me know in the comments what sort of passwordless methods you're using and any tips you have for other people watching the video. Of course, not everything can be passwordless yet, so YubiKeys won't cover you in all scenarios. That's why you should watch this video to learn about other ways you can protect your online accounts from getting hacked. In fact, I made a whole series about it, so check the video description in that video for links to the rest.